I don't think it's a political game.
Really?
But the thing is that people read into that in different ways, right?
Yeah, like, that's a tough, like, what do you mean by political?
That doesn't mean anything, right? The question, is this a political game, doesn't actually mean anything, because it's what does the word political mean to you? Do we touch topics that bear a resemblance to the geopolitics of the world we live in today? Hell yeah, because this is the subject matter of modern warfare. Are we telling a story that has anything to do with the specific governments of any countries that we are portraying? No.
Good day and warm wishes, everyone. This is Invader here, bringing you yet another video. There was a recent interview from Game Informer that caught my attention. They were chatting with Call of Duty Modern Warfare campaign gameplay director Jacob Minkoff and studio narrative director Taylor Kurosaki. The topic was about how they don't see the game's storyline as necessarily political. And of course, with it being a Call of Duty game, it's going to naturally have some kind of political element. So what does being political necessarily mean? What's the underlying question being asked here? Well, basically, it means talking about the Cheeto-looking president, Donald Trump.
Right? So, if you're asking, like, is Trump in the video game? No, he isn't.
Right?
Like,
right.
It's not. That's not
these are,
the
these
thing
are
we're
sort
doing.
Of like.
I suppose my first question is, why does it matter if they want to stay politically neutral? By default, developers should be trying to capture the attention of everyone and lure whatever audience is interested in their product. Both sides of the political spectrum buy video games, so it's good business trying to court consumers and not drive anyone away. For large franchises with numerous sequels, this is especially true. And ultimately, gamers don't mind politics in their games. It's just a matter of how it's presented to you. If you're being ham-fisted at companies or developers' personal propaganda, then yes, consumers are going to generally be turned off by this. It's really not that hard of a concept to understand, especially when consumers are getting visually assaulted every day by eerily similar takes in the general news media. There's a general distrust with media outlets, so it's no surprise that people in general don't want the daily stuff they're fed by the media in their games. They just want to relax.
Timeless questions, or maybe I should rephrase that. These are the types of questions that have been asked for the last 50 years. We do talk about concepts like colonialism and occupation and independence and freedom. We don't maybe say those words specifically, but that's the realm that we are in. But you could have a game that takes place in revolutionary America talk about those exact same
conflicts.
I mean, the specific story
that we're talking about like, proxy wars and the superpowers involved in Middle Eastern countries, you could set this in Afghanistan in the 80s and you'd have the same story, right? So, like, is it political?
There have been plenty of games that have politics, religion, and so on in them to some degree. They do so with varying emphasis and degrees. Games such as Command & Conquer, Rise of Nations, the Assassin's Creed games, Spec Ops The Line, Deus Ex, Fallout, The Saboteur, Wolfenstein, Homefront, and that's just to name a select few because there are a lot of games that address politics. How well they address these topics is another issue entirely, but needless to say, there's a plethora of games that delve into the topic.
Like in terms of in today's, are we tapping into the political zeitgeist of American politics?
I don't think that's the core of it, right? Yeah. But just like it's dealing with politics, it's discussing some larger themes.
Yeah, know? it's talking about, for example, concepts like in a world where superpowers vie for influence around the world and where those superpowers butt up, they don't directly fight each other. They utilize proxy allies on the ground to sort of do their bidding. That's a real thing that happens, and that's happened for the last 50 years. But what happens when those allies who are funded and armed and supported by the superpower, what happens when that support is abandoned or withdrawn? what happens to those local people then? And again, that's a question that you could have asked about Vietnam, or you could have asked about the war in Afghanistan, or you could have asked about colonial India, if you wanted to.
Secondly, well, as I stated earlier, these games naturally tend to have a bit of politics in them. As Call of Duty is a globe-spanning military shooter that usually leads and deals with military factions and terrorism. Call of Duty is no stranger to this, as back in 2009, Call of Duty Modern Warfare 2 had the infamous No Russian level, which had everyone and their grandmother talking about the mission where you have to watch terrorists take out civilians at an airport, thus preparing you for the narrative events of Modern Warfare 2 and leading into Modern Warfare 3. Now, personally, I haven't owned or bought a Call of Duty game since Call of Duty Ghosts, which in hindsight isn't so bad, taking into account the more recent iterations. Granted, I did download a free trial of Infinite Warfare and give it a go, but needless to say, this generation I've been kind of disappointed with how Call of Duty has been. However, after seeing the initial trailer for Modern Warfare and a bunch of recent multiplayer footage released, I'm actually really interested in this new game. It's got a really interesting campaign attached to it, traditional multiplayer elements, the return of Spec Ops co-op mode, and the recently announced Ground War featuring 64 player and vehicle battles, which honestly, that has me really excited. Now, granted, Activision will no doubt try to monetize the heck out of this game after it launches with greedy microtransactions, especially since the game will not have a season pass on additional multiplayer maps, they'll be free. So, you know, they'll get the gravy train flowing somehow, but that's for a different discussion at a different time.
Those are some concepts that have been around for a long time. So we want to delve into those questions and say, and again, in a world where nobody is purely good and nobody is purely evil, in that big, meaty gray area in between, the conflicts that arise out of people wanting to get their way and wanting to achieve what they consider victory, and the conflicts that kind of result from that, that's the meat of the conflicts that we want to examine.
I feel like for me, to honestly say, if you wanted a situation where I would say that yes, it is a political story, I would have to be telling a story about specifically the exact administrations and governments and events in our world today. We are talking about thematic things. We would also have to have, I think, a perspective on it. And what we don't, we want to present the different perspectives. We don't want to say that one of them is correct. Because what we want you to do is we want you to understand this is how these people feel, this is why they fight, this is the outcome of it, this is how these people feel, this is how these people feel. And what we want you to come away with at the end is an understanding of why all these different groups fight, or groups like them, and to have empathy for, I think, all of them, and what puts them in this situation that they then have to engage in war.
But what's interesting is that after this interview is made public, a slew of eerily similar articles start popping up right on cue, echoing a very similar narrative. Oh, I love this gem from Eurogamer. Sometimes the jovial tone in the industry doesn't fit the topic. I'm sure the killstreaks in the new COD Modern Warfare are fun from a gameplay perspective, but sometimes I think the tone of announcements, like the addition of white phosphorus and the return of nukes, place particular scrutiny on games. In this regard, my only solution is to raise awareness to why the inclusion of and gleeful tone at certain elements may raise eyebrows. If reporting within the games industry on these issues is responsible, I feel gamers may not put in a defensive position of being called unaware or irresponsible, but obviously it's not a perfect solution. Which, I mean, it's interesting Eurogamer comments on tone and eyebrows being raised in Modern Warfare, while in last week's review of Wolfenstein Youngblood, they praised the game for intensely satisfying combat, stating that while your arsenal is surprisingly limited, a fully stocked weapon wheel can be gleefully destructive, disintegrating foes into chunks of meat and muscle. Just, you know, interesting to say the least. Or there's this bit from this lovely article from Destructoid stating that, really, I'm just agitated that so many developers keep pushing this idea that games are completely removed from politics. It's especially mind-boggling when talking about Call of Duty, which is a military shooter deeply ingrained with political undertones. What I hear when these statements are made isn't, we're apolitical, but we're toothless cowards. Either commit to what you're doing or don't do it. And just really from that excerpt alone, you can tell the framing that this author is going for and what he means. Why didn't you just talk about the current world administrations in the game? Right? I mean, yes, it's true that Call of Duty has undertones of politics, but it just always represents the themes in their games. That's how they go about it. They don't hammer away at real-world politics necessarily. There's a lot of context. If you played the games, you'd understand that. They've covered world wars, the Cold War, modern times, and even futuristic settings, and yet have been very successful without getting bogged down by heavily laden politics. Modern Warfare is not the only game to come under the spotlight for not wanting to go heavy-handed with political tie-ins. Recently, The Outer Worlds creative director Leonard Boyarsky stated in an interview that the studio has become very careful not to lecture players with the themes featured in the game, saying that it's the last thing that they want to do. He went further, stating that, "I like money. I'm not against capitalism, and in a lot of ways, I'm happy with our society. But of course, there are a lot of ways in which it could be improved. We started development in April 2016, and a couple of things happened in world politics between then and now that nobody expected, and we weren't expecting that. I don't want people to think that this is a really hard, politically charged game. It's supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be humorous. And games that chose to feature political or heavily social justice influences instead of focusing on game content have been scrutinized fans by no end. For example, Battlefield 5 has underperformed and hemorrhaged fans because of their stances and underdelivered on game content and promises. So yeah, maybe it's not best to take heavily political stances in your work." Over the last few years, I've found that fans of Call of Duty have desired a return to more modern settings, with a return to classic playstyles. While it was interesting that they decided to do more futuristic takes and make changes to gameplay like adding parkour, the reception for them has been a bit mixed, so it's a welcome return to form. And fans are excited that Infinity Ward seem to be listening to the fans' feedback on the game. Feedback on important things like gameplay, game modes, weapons, killstreaks, and so on. Not in overtly political matters that need to be shoved into the game, and it feels like certain media outlets are more ideological driven than others, and really, that's not what fans want. Now, is this a shot at journalists? Well, no, of course not, but I think that most people who read gaming websites and follow their social media accounts can see where their priorities are, and how a few of them can skew things, and generally can see where they align politically. It's not so much about journalism anymore as it's in nudging along and pushing personal activism. Believe it or not, video games don't have to make statements, or at least not the way certain outlets lead you to believe. As of right now, to me, Modern Warfare looks like a welcome breath of familiar fresh air back to the series. I'm looking forward to the campaign, multiplayer, and a bunch of new modes being introduced. It definitely seems like a more complete package in comparison to previous entries in the series and similar games in the shooter genre. It just has me really invigorated again into the franchise, which is, well, something that I've really wanted back for a long time. I mostly have gripes with it at some point, but hey, as of right now, I'm thinking it's pretty cool. So what do you guys think about this? Are you okay with the campaign's tone for the next Call of Duty? Are you interested in picking it up? Do you think things are getting overblown by the gaming media outlets already? Definitely let me know in the comments down below and share your thoughts. Invader, out!